Hi guys, and welcome back for a new video. Today I'm going to show you the BIOS Gigabyte provides for their AX370 Gaming 5 motherboard for the AMD Ryzen CPUs. So this is how it looks. it boots by default into the classic mode, as they call it. It's practically the advanced mode. You have all the available tabs in the upper side. The time and date here. On the right, there's a slide menu that shows you the real time values for the frequency and backlog of your CPU, the temperature and the core voltage, the memory frequency and the available memory amount, the memory voltage and the power line voltages as well. There's also a help button here that provides info about the selected section, the selected setting in the BIOS. And there's also another slide menu, this one, which allows you to change the language, but you should pay attention to this because there's no drop down menu. The change is instantly once you click it. So let's get back to English. Then there's the Qflash module for flashing your BIOS. You can choose to update the BIOS or even save the BIOS to a USB flash drive. And also there's the smart fan. This is the tool they provide to allow you to set up your all your fans that are connected to the motherboard. So we have the CPU optional, the system fan 1, 2, 3, 4, and two connectors for water pumps. So let's start with the CPU fan. We have this is the RPM curve, the default one. You can on the right you can see the temperature and the fan speed. Also you can set up warnings here for different temperatures, like this. You can also enable or disable the CPU fan fail warning. And finally, you can see here all the temperature in your system. For the control part, there are a few presets. So the first one is normal, then there's a silent profile. You see this this curve changed here. Then we have the manual one, so you can change the speed of the fan in relation to the temperature. can even if you have a big CPU cooler, a big and efficient CPU cooler, you can even choose to turn the fan completely off below certain temperature, like this. And there's also the full speed mode that basically will apply the maximum RPM to your fan. And if you want to do some settings and then apply them to all available fans, you can do just that. You don't need to set each fan if you want to use the same settings. So you press this and you select which fans you want to use this setting. Also, you can choose the temperature input. Okay, let's choose another fan because for the CPU you can't choose a different temperature input. Let's choose the first system fan. So, if you want to put it to manual mode or even to silent or whatever other preset, you can select different temperature inputs. So basically, you can choose to allow the motherboard to adjust the fan speed in relation to the temperature for the chipset or the CPU or the VRM, for example, or even for the system temperature. It's your choice. Then you can also you can change the temperature interval, and this is very good. It's very good. We have fan control mode because you can choose to use voltage mode or PWM. This is a very important setting for those of you that have that are using fans with 3 or 4 pins. Okay, so basically this is the smart fan tool. It's pretty nice and convenient to use, and it can help you to get your system to be silent and also cool at the same time. Okay, let's get back. And before diving into the advanced mode, I am going to quickly show you the easy mode as well. This is how it looks. So you have an information section, a section for the CPU temperature, the voltage for the CPU core, and the system temperature. Then there's an easy overclocking tool, but I don't know, it is not working with my 1800X CPU. I don't know why it is not available. It is not supported. Anyway, then you have the SATA information. I only have one SSD connected right now. And then there's the DRAM status. You can see here the running frequency and the available DIMMs. And you can choose to use the XMP profile. But it is not changing in real time. You need to reboot. because the XMP profile should apply the 2933 megahertz frequency. Then there's the boot sequence. Can drag and drop. Here you can see all the fans. We can choose to enable or disable AMD RAID Expert technology, and also we can access the smart fan from the easy mode as well. And there's also the help, which gives you a list with the available shortcuts. And let's get back to classic mode. So, the MIT tab basically provides you with all the important settings for any overclocking you might want to do here. So the first one is the advanced frequency settings. Okay, double click. We can change the CPU clock ratio. But for this, we need to use the keyboard. Okay, so the minimum one is 8 and the maximum. Oh, sorry. So you need to know this is a bit stupid. You need to know the maximum. You can't just punch it there, but it seems the maximum is 63.75, so I don't think any of you will use this clock ratio anyway. Then we have the advanced CPU core settings. So there's the clock ratio again, the core performance boost setting, which has disabled and auto options, the AMD cool and quiet function for lowering your power consumption under idle mode, the virtualization setting integrated into your CPU, the global sysstate control, also in charge with lowering the power consumption under idle mode, the simultaneous multi-threading, and the downcore control. This last one allows you to select how many cores you want to use. This is only useful if you want to do some hardcore overclocking, or if you have somehow broken some of your cores. But in any other situation, you need to leave this to auto. We can apply the XMP profile here, and you can see it automatically selected the 2933 megahertz, because these are 3 gigahertz rated modules. But if we want to, we can change the multiplier manually like this, up to 32. Okay, let's put it to auto. Go back, advanced memory settings. We have the multiplier again, and the memory timing mode. There's the auto, or you can choose to manually set them. Channel interleaving, rank interleaving, and then the sub timings. We can do this only for channel A, but there's also the advanced manual mode that allows us to independently set the timings for each separate channel. Okay, but I'll leave them on auto for now. Next, we have the voltage settings. So, for the CPU core, we can use. There's auto. We can't do anything here with double click. So we need to use the keyboard again. I'm using plus, and it just switched to normal. And this move activated the dynamic VCore, which is basically an offset mode, and we can go from minus 0.15 volts up to 0.35 volts. Okay. And after normal, if we punch plus again, we can manually adjust the voltage from 0.8 up to 1.8 volts. Okay, let's switch back to auto. And there's the same for VCore SLC. This is basically useful in case you want to, might be useful actually, in case you want to overclock your memory. So it goes in offset mode, in dynamic mode, it goes from minus 0.15 up to 0.35 volts. And if we want to set it manually, it goes from 0.8 and up to 1.8 volts. Okay. there are also other voltages you can adjust here. Like this. The DRAM can go up to 2 volts, which is humongous for DDR4. Especially that the maximum multiplier is 32x. Then there's the VCore load line calibration. So we can't do anything with our mouse here. So, oh, sorry. So I'm going to use plus and minus again. So it goes like this: auto, normal, standard, low, medium, and the high. Sorry, high, turbo, and extreme. And it's the same here. Let's go back. PC health status. Here you can see the case open status, which can be enabled or disabled. Right now it is the case is open because it actually doesn't exist, as this is an open platform. And you can also see here the all the voltages. It might seem a bit strange that there are no temperatures here, but this is because you can see the temperature here, right here, and the fan speeds are available in the smart fan module. Okay, let's go back and miscellaneous settings. Okay, we can choose the mode for the PCI Express slot, and we can choose to enhance performance under 3D Mark 2001. So we can go to smart fan tool from here as well. Next tab is the system tab, where you can select your language, your desired language as well, but this time we have a drop down menu, so this is much better. And we can set the time and date like this, but you will need to use your keyboard again with plus and minus, and for the system time the same. next one is called BIOS, and you can choose the boot priority, the hard drive priorities, the numlock state, security options. You can choose to enable or disable the full screen logo, and you can enable or disable the fast boot. Then there are Windows 10 features. Like this. With compatibility support module enabled or disabled. And the boot option for LAN. We can choose legacy or UEFI mode for storage boot, and UEFI or legacy for the PCI devices, and the network stack as well. Then we can set up the administrator password and the user password. It's strange, if I press escape, it shows me this. Yeah, I think this is a bug or something. Next, we have the peripherals. So we have the first one is the integrated TPM. We can enable or disable it. And the LED connect, LED connect feature. And then there's the RGB fusion control, where you can you can change how the onboard LEDs will work. Because this this motherboard is an Aura motherboard, an Aorus motherboard, and it has RGB LEDs on board that you can control. So you can choose the effect you want to use. You can and you can change the color as well. And you should know this this is done in real time. Okay, back. We have legacy USB support. The handoff for XHCI and EHCI. The port emulation. The mass storage support. Wow, this looks pretty ugly. You see the close button is right on top of the text. The USB. The power provided for the USB ports. There's some voltage compensation, as you can see, if there's needed. The audio controller. We have some trusted computing here. There's no security device installed right now. The NVMe controller, but there's no NVMe device installed. And the off-board SATA controllers. But I'm not using any PCI Express SATA controllers. Okay, so this is definitely a bug, because when I'm pressing escape, it gets me to I don't know to trusted computing menu. Okay, chipset. Enable, disabled, and auto. The SATA mode, SATA controller can has HCI and ride modes. The chipset SATA ports enabled or disabled, and here you can see the installed devices. This is my SSD, the Intel SSD. It is installed on SATA port number 3. Next, power. We have these options for AC back on. So when you have power loss, you can choose the system to go back on. when the AC gets back, or to remember the last state, or to stay off, to stay turned off. We can power on the system by keyboard. Or by password. This is still by keyboard. Power on by mouse. So move or double click. We have ERP. Off by power button. Instant or with some delay. Resume by alarm. Wake on LAN. And high precision event timer, which is by default enabled. Finally, we can save and exit. We can override the boot sequence. We can load the optimized defaults, which you already saw. And we can save profiles or load profiles. I'm loading my right now. I will load my overclock profile to show you what you can do with this motherboard. It's not much, but it's something. Okay, so let's get back to MIT tab. I'm using the 40.25 CPU clock ratio, which will give you 4.025 gigahertz frequency for your CPU. I'm using this frequency because this is the maximum I could achieve while keeping my system 100% stable. Also, I chose to enable the cool and quiet and the sysstate control, but you should know that this is quite useless as they don't seem to work while you are overclocking the CPU because it will run at the 4.025 gigahertz even under idle mode. So it won't lower its frequency, although it should have. I'm using, of course, the XMP profile because I want to use the 2933 megahertz frequency. I tried the 3200 megahertz frequency, but the system will not boot. Okay, so as you can see, everything is in auto mode because all the necessary settings are included in the XMP profile. And for the voltage, I chose to use the dynamic mode. So I added 0.025 volts to the normal voltage, but I also tested the manual mode, and for stability I needed to apply 1.375 volts. And I chose the extreme mode for the CPU vCore load line calibration. The rest is unchanged. And of course I chose the silent profile for the CPU because I want my system to be not only fast but also silent when it's not running any difficult tasks. Yeah, and that's pretty much everything about this motherboard's BIOS. I hope you enjoyed it. I must say this BIOS is pretty basic. It's not that complex as I was expecting. In fact I was expecting much better from a Gigabyte high-end motherboard. And I must say I was expecting a bit better overclocking capability. So this is it. I hope you enjoyed it, and see you next time.